The early 20th century marked a transitional era for the previously bonded American captives, in every sense of the phrase. As the institution of shackles loosened, the institution of identity tightened. Many traditional Southerners found themselves making their way out of the Jim Crow South to the more urbanized and industrialized modern areas of Northern and Midwest cities, which were seen as more racially progressive. As well, during the time, many of these people became estranged from the Southern religion of their parents' and grandparents' generations.
In the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost,
social disenfranchisement put these people in a unique position of seeking a new refuge in a new religion, whom they felt represented their best interests for social advancement. Enter movements like Garvey's United Negro Improvement Association, a demanding organization whose tenets were more centered around separation, segregation, and relocation than their more socially palatable rivals at the NAACP. In spite of the fact that he was ultimately unsuccessful in creating a sustainable organization, Marcus Garvey did provide a blueprint for others to emulate. But more importantly, he had accumulated a database of people looking for a rebound relationship after the collapse of the UNIA and his subsequent deportation. Garvey had galvanized a significant base of immigrants and indigenous Americans under his flagship cause. But with his absence, it was time for some opportunists to come siphon some steam from the SS Phyllis Wheatley. As the underlying theme within the Garvey movement, some opportunists sought to attach themselves to the supposed relationship Americans had with the continent of Africa. In Garvey's case, his utmost desire was to establish a kingdom in Africa and fill its borders with deported Americans. But this was the part of the plan that most native-born Americans took serious issue with. As with echoes from generations prior, also called Back to Africa plans that founded countries like Sierra Leone and Liberia, were never supported by the majority of so-called blacks. Yet the seeds being continuously planted over those generations permeated the consciousness of the so-called American Negro, bringing to light the questions about his own identity. Compounded with the newly introduced system of indoctrination or education being imposed on children in the early 20th century, the field was ripe for self-seeking in every sense of the word. The fledgling African trend was being levied from all sides of the American experience, from the church that literally has African in its title to the first African lodge, number one, and from the government-mandated education system to some of the most militant black nationalist groups of the time. Their choir sang the circle of life in a rhythmless unison.
Time to check my social media.
Along with this fresh affinity for that land across the sea, sprouted a branch from that African tree of influence. This branch, likened to the tree prior, was an idea. The idea being that the people in America were descendants of prior generations of captives who were kidnapped from the continent of Africa. Therefore, they were African. Thus, the religion of their ancestors was African as well. This silent question of identity opened the door for Islam to take foothold among the disenfranchised in America. Two of the most notable factions were the Moorish Science Temple and the Nation of Islam.
Oh.
The Moorish Science Temple is founded upon one primary tenet, and that is the so-called people labeled as African Americans were descended from the ancient Moabites. Its founder, Timothy Drew, later known as Noble Drew Ali, also believed that the location from which American blacks hailed from was the Moroccan Empire, and referred to the racial classification of his following as Asiatics. Drew was born in 1886 under some degree of contested ancestry. Varying sources attest that Drew was born to former Cherokee slaves and adopted by an aunt. Another says he was the son of a Cherokee chief and a Washita mother, while other reports say he was born to a Moroccan father and a Cherokee mother. Whether or not Drew was actually born to a Moroccan father has been a matter of dispute among Moorish historians. In any event, Drew found himself within the trenches of a pursuit of an Islamic identity, not only just for himself, but for the thirsty hearts of those lost in a spiritual wilderness. His life prior to 1918 is somewhat shrouded in mystery, though notable sources record through certain documents, including labor and draft records from his early life in Virginia, until when he appears as a laborer at Port Newark, and then a year later in 1918 registering for the draft. Much of the narrative relating to his early life has been considerably mythologized over the years. According to multiple sources, which also correspond with Moorish legend, Drew traveled as a magician with a band of gypsies at a young age, and through his relationship with the circus, visited countries like Egypt and Morocco. While there, reportedly studied Islam under an Egyptian mystic priest, and was given a lost section of the Quran. And from this point, the legend is born. Drew was essentially deified by the priest, who labeled him as a reincarnation of Buddha, Confucius, Jesus, and Muhammad. According to legend, with this hidden section of the Quran and other Gnostic writings, Noble Drew Ali would later publish his own book, The Holy Koran of the Moorish Science Temple, aka the Circle 7 Quran. His book included the Aquarian Gospel of Jesus Christ, along with other elements borrowed from Kabbalah, Hermeticism, and Christian mysticism, even incorporating esoteric writings from the Order of the Rosy Cross. Prior to his ascension, Drew lived two contradictory lifestyles. On one hand, he traveled internationally to several countries in North Africa and Asia. On the other, he lived the very common lifestyle of an uneducated Negro from the South looking for a better life in a northern city. For historians, these contrasting lifestyles were hard to reconcile into a satisfactory background of Drew Ali, and much speculation arose about the legitimacy of his legend, which seemed to be nicely woven into a fabric of folklore aggrandizing a misbegotten history. Ali's teachings could only be described as his own unique religion. Although labeled along the lines of Islam, much of his doctrines connected more intimately with Christian mysticism. For example, the Aquarian Gospel of Jesus Christ, which is included in the Circle 7 Quran, is a work written by Levi Dowling, a Gnostic Christian who attempted to build a compound in Redondo Beach, California for his followers in 1904, which was supposed to be the Holy Land for Gnostics. But Dowling's dream of a Gnostic Holy Land ultimately fell short. In his text, The Aquarian Gospel of Jesus Christ, Dowling took the liberty of filling in the blanks left in the unwritten narratives during the life of Christ. Dowling attests that his writings concerning the lost 18 years during the life of Jesus from childhood to manhood are absolutely true. In Dowling's narrative, an 18-year period covers the life of Jesus unknown that catalogs his biblically undocumented travels to India, Tibet, Persia, Assyria, and Greece. Biblical scholar Edgar Goodspeed attested that Dowling's work borrowed significantly from the apocryphal Gospel of James, therefore meaning that the Circle 7 Quran, for all intents and purposes, contains a substantial influence from Christian Gnostic philosophy. A peculiar philosophy would best describe the foundation of the Moorish Science Temple doctrine, because it would not strictly adhere to the established regulations practiced by the vast majority of Muslims worldwide. Rather, it resembled New Age scientism and incorporated elements of theosophy, a New Age religion founded by occultist Helena Blavatsky in 1875. Moorish science also incorporated Eastern religions such as Hinduism, Buddhism, in addition to Kabbalah. On the surface, Ali's mission for the temple was clear. He wanted to build a program centered around the self-upliftment of so-called African Americans, and also wanted them to get in touch with their ancestral roots, which he believed to be Moorish Islamic. In several ways, Drew's temple intersected with Garveyism in this aspect, but varied in his belief of a specific North African heritage, as opposed to Garvey's general continental heritage applied to all Negroes. While Garvey claimed the entire continent of Africa, Ali only claimed the northern, predominantly Islamic countries, but also asserts that the Moorish ancestors built the holy city of Mecca in Saudi Arabia on the continent of Asia. Hence, part of his reasoning for labeling his followers Asiatics. The exact date of when the temple was first in operation has also been a matter of dispute. Most followers of the Moorish temple recognize the year 1913, when the Canaanite temple was said to be founded in Newark, New Jersey. However, records corroborating this date are scant at best. The problem with this was the fact that if the Canaanite temple in Newark, New Jersey had been in operation during the year 1913, there was no record. And the earliest record of the Canaanite temple in New Jersey's operation is brought to us by a man named Abdul Hamid Suleiman. Quote from Journal of Race, Ethnicity, and Religion. Quote, most accounts of Ali's religious genesis began with his founding of the Canaanite Temple in 1913, Newark, New Jersey, without actually proving its veracity and accuracy. Interestingly, Ali himself never utilized the term Canaanite Temple in his literature. At best, he indirectly insinuated his pre-1925 beginnings in the Koran Questions number 9 and 10, claiming the Moorish Science Temple was founded in Newark, New Jersey in 1913, but without actually revealing the name of this proto-Moorish Science Temple of America temple, its exact location, or its doctrines. Contrary to Ali's declaration, his phase of religious leadership did not actually begin in 1913, Newark, New Jersey, as the draft card revealed Drew to be a laborer by the SBC in Port Newark in 1918. Rather, this scrimply described religious past was crafted by Ali to suppress his proto-Moorish Newark identity as Professor Drew, and to veil the historical truth that the actual Canaanite temple was founded by Abdul Hamid Suleiman, as part of his larger ancient Mecca Medina of ancient free and operative Masons, a network of Black Mohammedan Masonic movements operating in various cities in the 1910s and the 1920s. Still, Drew's evolution from Professor Drew to Prophet Noble Drew Ali in Newark City demonstrated Drew's organizational genius in his shrewd rewriting of the Newark's historical religious past by erasing Suleiman's tutelage over the Canaanite temple and interpolating himself into MTSA literature. His calculating selecting of a Potnet surname Ali to boost his image among African Americans and opportunism in seizing advantage of the disintegrating remains of Suleiman's Canaanite temple in 1923 to fashion out the earliest stirrings of Moorish temple science and retaining Mecca-centric elements of the Canaanite past into the MTSA to attract former Canaanite followers. End quote. Suleiman was an Egyptian or Sudanese transplant and was one of the first immigrants to attempt to Islamicize American blacks. But additionally, he was a well-respected and high-ranking member of the Mecca-Medina Order of Ancient and Operative Freemasons, which included multiple cities throughout the country in the early 20th century. And he was also well acquainted with prominent Garveyite Freemasons in Harlem. Quote, after Negro Shriners, High Priest of Mecca would put him in right light. He's close to the great prophet. Abdul Hamid offers real thing in Mohammedan masonry. Master of Quran gets mixed and miffed when asked to answer pointed questions. New York World Friday. He wrote to the world saying, I am Abdul Hamid Suleiman of the city of Khartoum, Sudan, Egypt, a Mohammedan by birth, master of the Quran, having pilgrimaged to Mecca three times and thus become an eminent high priest and head of all Masonic degrees in Mecca, Arabia. From the first to the 96th degree, am now in the United States for the purpose of establishing the rite of the ancient Arabic order of the nobles of the mystic shrine. I, Abdul Hamid Suleiman, make this proclamation that there has never been a Negro Shriner in the United States that was not bogus in infringing upon the white man's rights. Until now, I have given a Shriner's patent to Caesar R. Blake of North Carolina. I am here to answer all questions relative to these degrees until I return home to Mecca to enroll the names of the true Shriners of this country. Accordingly, a reporter for the New York World made a pilgrimage to Suleiman's address, number 143 West 130th Street. He found the blackest of Ethiopians sitting on the top step of the stoop, fanning himself gravely. Does Abdul Hamid Suleiman live here? The reporter asked. I am the man, was the answer to the first of 4 hours of questions. Come upstairs. Suleiman is arranging to receive the hundreds of thousands of American Negroes who call themselves Freemasons and Mystic Shriners into a Mohammedan masonry. Now that they are being enjoined by the white Freemasons and Shriners through the civil courts from using the copyrighted society names, titles, regalia, and insignia of the American organizations. Suleiman says, the white men are right in enjoining the Negroes because the Negroes have had no authentic Masonic charter. They have merely set themselves up as Freemasons. The purpose is now to make them authentic by virtue of his authority as eminent high priest, to grant a charter in a masonry which he declares to be ancient and widespread throughout the Mohammedan world. Must take oath and pay. He will only do this if the Negroes swear the death penalty oath by the beard of the prophet that they will live according to the moral code of the Quran and that they will pay to Mecca through none but Suleiman a proportion of their lodge dues, which is now being negotiated. A Mohammedan charter is already in possession of Caesar R. Blake of Charlotte, North Carolina, Imperial Potnet of a society of Negroes which has been going by the name AEA, Order of Masonic Shriners. It will become effective, Suleiman says, as soon as the negotiations are concluded to his satisfaction and his priestly seal is affixed to it. Pharaoh
Shriner too? Suleiman says the Mohammedan masonry he represents pervades the whole Mohammedan world and controls both religious worship and civil government. That the titles of Sharif, Sheikh, Pasha, Khedive, Sahib are nothing but the topmost of the Masonic degrees, in this order given, with the Sharif as the highest. The encyclopedia, however, does not mention any such masonry, and living authorities say it's all news to them and that the declaration about the titles is nonsense. Nevertheless, Suleiman promises these titles will be given to American Negroes who join Mohammedan masonry. Before the interview ended, Suleiman had decided that perhaps it would be better to use the name Nobles of Sahara for his adherents in this country instead of Shriners, and that they had better not use the insignia he wears. He thinks the proper insignia will be the seal of Pharaoh, pictured in a Sunday supplement a few weeks ago as excavated at the ruins of Carchemish. Pharaoh was a Shriner, he said. End quote. New York World, 1922. Quote, in April 1923, the popularity of Suleiman's colored Canaanite temple at the corner of Bank and Rutgers Street, Newark, nosedived when Suleiman and his assistant, Muhammad Ali, were charged and arrested by the Supreme Court of New Jersey for the carnal abuse of a follower's child. With the leaders embroiled in legal matters, a bitter struggle for the temple's power and purse strings followed. One faction named itself as Canaanite Temple No. 1, based at 102 Morton Street, Newark, and legally incorporated itself for the purpose of religious worship and teaching of religion, Muslim, and Islam. Professor Drew, the Egyptian adept Muslim, who resided a mere 3 miles away from Canaanite Temple No. 1, was not oblivious to the confusion within leadership echelons of Suleiman's temple. End quote. From this moment, Drew ascended through his opportunistic reorganization of the rubble left behind after Suleiman's incarceration. Over the next 2 years, the newly fashioned noble Drew Ali campaigned across the country promoting his peculiar philosophy, traveling as far south as South Carolina and as far west as Chicago, where he eventually settled and built a home base in 1925. The greater majority of all Moors lived in the city of Chicago. Quote, the Moorish Manufacturing Company, maker of the various herbal treatments, was not the only business venture of the Moors. To achieve economic independence and the sense of self-worth necessary to overcome racist employment patterns, the Moors in Chicago also established restaurants, grocery stores, and variety stores. Although ownership was unclear, it would be logical to assume that the Moorish Science Temple owned at least one of the Chicago properties out of which it operated. There were several addresses: Unity Hall, also called Unity Club, the headquarters of the organization, which could be rented out for parties, dances, balls, receptions, banquets, etc. At 3140 Indiana Avenue, the location of the Moorish Manufacturing Company, at 3603 Indiana Avenue, and the location of the home office at 3229 Indiana Avenue, a change from the previous address of 3718 Prairie Avenue. By the 1940s, the Moors would acquire farmland. But long before then, the idea of establishing a living space separate from the rest of America had taken root. Thus, a small article entitled Moors Endorse Village Idea appeared in a 1929 edition of the Moorish Guide, and in part reads as follows. The following letter is one of the many received by the guide relative to the establishment of a town owned and completely operated by those persons belonging to the Moorish Science Temple of America, January 29th, 1929. In response to the question asked concerning the Moors having a town, homes, etc., we will say, all honor the prophet who is to give us something of our own. Signed, Brother E and D Jackson Bay, Sister J Jackson Bay, end quote.
As the temple grew, it reached a following of over 30,000 members across several states and cities. But with the increasing popularity came increased government surveillance and infiltration. Noble Drew Ali wasn't known for promoting anti-Americanism or any sort of radicalism. In fact, the opposite would be true. He propagated messages of self-respect, love for mankind, good citizenship, and voter participation. Be all this as it may, it didn't stop the government from hiring informants and dissenters within the Moorish Science Temple walls.
Continuing, in Chicago, hundreds of Moors employed the identification card as an amulet, believing that the mere sight of the card would be sufficient to restrain a white man who was bent on disturbing or harming its holder. Moors were supposedly actually accosting whites in public, singing the praises of their prophet because he had freed them from the curse of the European. In Detroit, the Moors were becoming odious in the eyes of law enforcement, as is evident in the eyewitness account of one Detroit police officer. "These fellas," he cried out, "were a terrible gang. Thieves and cutthroats. Wouldn't answer anything, wouldn't sit down if you told them, wouldn't stand up when you told them, pretending they didn't understand you, that they were Moors from Morocco. They never saw Morocco. Those Moors never saw anything before they came to Detroit, except Florida or Alabama." Noble Drew Ali was facing the crisis of conflict in his own message. He consistently required his followers to observe the law of the land. On one hand, his argument for the embrace of Moroccan identity as a necessary precursor to full acceptance in North America suggests that he was not interested in a radical political solution to the
intransigence of racism.
On the other hand, he had created a psychological space, a terrain of the mind, wherein racial separation was envisioned and anticipated. That is, the disequilibria of the society was not a condition to be long endured. Its resolution was not only a matter of time. For many of its followers, that time had come. Whether disinterested in or unprepared for confrontation with the U.S. government, Noble Drew Ali recalled the 1920 chastening of Redding's Abyssinian movement and acted to lessen the level of tensions. The January 15, 1929 edition of the Moorish Guide carried the following order. Prophet warns all Muslims, governors ordered to read proclamation at each reading. "I hereby inform all members that they must end all radical agitating speeches while at work, in their homes, or in the streets. We are for peace, not destruction. Stop flashing your cards at Europeans. It causes confusion. Remember, your card is for your salvation. Failure to obey these orders will be of severe consequence. We are for love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. And when these principles are violated, justice must then take its course. Any member or group members who hold malicious feelings toward the temple or the prophet or violate the divine covenant of the Moorish movement will receive their reward from Allah for their unjust deeds. All true Moors will and must obey the law as laid down to them by their prophet. If they lose confidence in their prophets, they should turn in their card and button, cease as wearing their turban and fez, and return to the state where I, the prophet, found you. This is a holy and divine movement founded by the prophet Noble Drew Ali, and if the prophet is not right, the temple is not right. While initial membership was free, monthly dues were 50 cents, and buttons could be purchased for a one-time fee of 25 cents. In this way, Moorish science functioned practically as a mutual aid society, further explaining its attractiveness to members who, in addition to spiritual guidance, also received benefits that included such provisions as unemployment and disability assistance. In addition to charging for initial membership, some leaders were also borrowing money from their parishioners. Noble Drew Ali enjoined temple branch leaders from borrowing from any member more than $5 to $10 unless by notification of the prophet. Some were apparently purchasing properties with temple money, resulting in the following corrective from Noble Drew Ali. When any said the temple desires to purchase property, they must first notify the grand body or the prophet, and it must be purchased under the name of the Moorish Science Temple of America, or Noble Drew Ali. An individual's name should never be applied. I, Noble Drew Ali, am responsible for all finance. Therefore, let I, the prophet, know what is on me. There was also an emergency fund that Noble Drew wanted to increase to a total of $91,000. To avoid graft, he demanded that these monies be deposited in a bank under the temple's name, to be drawn only by the treasurer in times of crisis. All of this points to mounting difficulties within the movement, mostly disputes over money with religious leaders, to the extent that Noble Drew Ali was gradually becoming overwhelmed. Some of you have slipped and slipped drastically, so you had better lace up your shoes before I get there. Everything, every business transaction, or anything pertaining to finance is to be transacted in the name of the Moorish Science Temple of America, or Noble Drew Ali. We Moors must maintain a grand treasurer, just as in the days of our forefathers. Then you are a nation. Until then, you are nothing. End quote. As was the case with Garvey's UNIA, there was never any real speculation that Ali personally misappropriated any funds received by the temple from his followers, despite the fact Ali had total control of the bank accounts along with the treasury. His financial acumen has never been called into question by historians. This doesn't mean that the temple didn't have its own financial struggles, but none were theorized due to Ali's mismanagement. In several documented speeches, Ali lobbies his followers for uplifting funds. Continuing, there is no indication that Noble Drew Ali was himself involved with corrupt monetary practices. The matter of the quality of his reception by branch temples was raised on occasion, as it would appear that local temples were responsible for financial arrangements attended to Noble Drew's visits. But references to the matter may reflect an inattentiveness on the part of the local temples, as opposed to any penchant toward opulence on the part of Noble Drew. The question of his personal finances therefore remains open, as demonstrated by his February 5th, 1929 correspondence to a local temple leader. Islam, dear brother, if you desire to see me earlier, you will have to notify your members under a heavy restriction and warning that the more uplifting funds they send me, the sooner they can see me, and the more I know they desire to see me, because I have to raise the finance of a few thousand dollars to place the nation far beyond their present conditions. It takes finance to uplift a downtrodden people and to place it among other prosperous nations of the world. And as a sacrifice to the Muslim creed, I have sacrificed my life, finance, and labor to place the nation on an intelligent and financial footing. This matter is to be attended to at once. I will be among those first to appreciate me as a prophet and the great work I am doing. Such a letter can be read cynically. Conversely, we need to raise money for any enterprise is ever present so there is no compelling reason to doubt Noble Drew Ali's motives. Struggles over local temple autonomy, temple finances, and temple businesses quickly moved from generalized and veiled verbal assaults to open confrontation one fateful day. Apparently convinced that he enjoyed the necessary backing, Sheikh Claude D. Green, Noble Drew Ali's business manager, small-time politician, and former butler to philanthropist Julius Rosenwald, threw all of Noble Drew Ali's office furniture into the street at 3140 Indiana Avenue, site of the Unity Club, and declared himself the Grand Sheikh. According to the Chicago Defender, Green had broken with Noble Drew and had directed that all revenues from merchandise and herbal remedies be sent to the Unity Club rather than Noble Drew's home and business headquarters at 3603 Indiana Avenue. Quote, DrAlimElBay.com. The prophet attended a meeting on February 15, 1929, where Supreme Grand Governor James Lomax Bay stated that he was now in power and the finance was now his in front of 1,500 members, and he brought charges against the prophet, claiming the prophet embezzled $8,000, when in reality it was Supreme Grand Governor Lomax Bay who embezzled the $8,000 from the prophet and the Moorish Science Temple of America with the help of Supreme Business Manager Claude Green Bay, attempting to set up Prophet Noble Drew Ali with rape charges and stage a coup and take over the movement. Supreme Business Manager Claude Green Bay and Supreme Grand Governor James Lomax Bay accused the prophet of spending temple funds on his extracurricular activities. By this time, 1929, Drew's movement had boasted more than 100,000 followers, and his annual salary was listed at $36,000, a fortune at the time. Allegedly, the prophet received additional stipends for his living expenses, including the mortgage payment for his luxurious trappings on Chicago's South Side, and the salaries for his chauffeur, maid, butler, and other domestic attendants. Allegedly, he kept several wives, a host of concubines, and fathered at least 20 children. When he tired of one wife, he would quietly divorce her and marry another. He also kept four women at the same time and paid for each of them to live in separate homes. End quote. On the Ides of March, Green was killed in retaliation, having been shot and stabbed four times in the neck and the body in his Unity Club office by some six or eight assailants. Accounts differ over the whereabouts of Noble Drew at the time of the homicide. Some maintain that he was out of town, while others contend he was hiding two blocks down the street at 3365 Indiana Avenue, where a feast had been in progress shortly after the word reached him that Green had been slain. In any event, the pursuing investigation turned up an informant, Small Bay, who told police that Green was the head of a breakaway faction and that Noble Drew had given the responsibility of having him bumped off to George Ira Johnson Bay L. Rumors swirled that Green had embezzled temple funds, had succeeded in drawing temple branch leaders such as Edward Lomax Bay of Detroit after him, and was involved with one of Noble Drew's wives, Pearl Drew Ali. Noble Drew and nine others were arrested and jailed, and their trial date set for May 20th. End quote. Following the murder of Brother Green, Noble Drew was arrested on May 20th and jailed under suspicion, but he Sahara sidestepped any indictment. Tragically, Ali would only spend another 2 months as a free man before dying under mysterious circumstances.
The officially documented cause of death on his certificate is listed as tuberculosis bronchopneumonia. However, regardless of this official documentation, his devotees remain suspicious about that official narrative.
Quote, Stephen Gibbons and George Ira Johnson Bay L, meanwhile, were among several who claimed that the dead prophet's spirit had entered their bodies. John Gibbons L, Noble Drew's chauffeur, reportedly fainted shortly after Noble Drew's death while working on his car, and upon examination was said to have the sign of the star and the crescent in his eyes, indicating that right then he was the prophet reincarnated into his chauffeur, therefore proclaiming himself Brother Prophet. In late September, 2 months after Noble Drew Ali's death, gunplay erupted between the Chicago police and the Moors at Temple headquarters. Two officers and one member would remain on the floor, with one officer seriously wounded. 63 Moors were arrested, including George Ira Johnson Bay L, who went to the federal penitentiary for life. End quote.
The death of Noble Drew Ali exposed a number of brothers who had been silently watching the throne. But now, with the absence of the prophet, the door opened for contenders to the crown, or contenders in search of their own. One of these contenders in search of a crown was a man shrouded in even more mystery than Noble Drew Ali.
Quote, according to this informed speculation, Fard Muhammad was born Wali Dad Fard on February 25, 1891 in New Zealand. His father, Zared Fard, an East Indian, and either Zared Fard or his parents came to New Zealand from what is now Pakistan. Fard Muhammad's mother, Beatrice, was a white English woman living in New Zealand. Such specificity is an improvement over previous inquiries into Fard Muhammad's birth in either New Zealand or Portland, Oregon, to his parents, who were either Hawaiian or Polynesian and British. Of course, this conflicts with the belief that Fard Muhammad was an Arab from the Middle East, a notion preserved in Fard Muhammad's self-presentation to black folk in Detroit in the early 1930s.
My name is W.D. Fard. I come from the holy city of Mecca. More about myself I will not tell you yet, for the time has not yet come. I am your brother. You have not yet seen me in my royal robes.
The Meccan theme developed in the nascent nation, and it held that Fard Muhammad was not only born in Mecca, but was a member of the Quraysh tribe and closely tied to the Hashemite Sharifs, physically related to the 16th century prophet Muhammad. End quote.
The collection of myths abound regarding Wallace Fard Muhammad, but there has always been one consistent legend amongst everyone who has ever encountered him personally. He claimed a Meccan heritage, and furthermore, that Arabia was the homeland for American blacks. This point stands in some opposition from the prior movement of Ali's Moorish Science Temple, which held the belief that Morocco was the original homeland for American blacks, and differed significantly from Garvey's movement, which was entirely Afrocentric on the surface.
Continuing, prior to his 1930 advent in Detroit, Fard Muhammad apparently spent time in Oregon and California, where he may have married and had children, in addition to pursuing various business ventures, not of all which may have been lawful. The probability that he entered the United States from Canada illegally in 1913 with the financial support of his parents, along with the need to anglicize his name, explains his various aliases, including Wallace D. Fard, Wallace D. Ford, and Fred Dodd. Neither his aliases nor his difficulties with life and the law are of concern here, but the possibility that Fard Muhammad, George Fard, and Wallace D. Ford may have been the same person is of great potential relevance. If true, it gives additional insight into the connections between Moorish science, the Ahmadiyya movement, the UNIA, and the Nation of Islam. As George Fard and Wallace D. Ford's activities in the 1920s are of interest. A member of the Theosophical Society in San Francisco in 1921, Fard was a member of the UNIA there and espoused a philosophy very consistent with the view subsequently promoted by the nation toward whites. As for Wallace D. Ford, he spent 3 years in prison before relocating to Chicago in 1929, before Noble Drew's demise, where he joined the Moorish Science Temple while attending an Ahmadiyya mosque on the city's south side. The conflation of these three persons suggests that Fard Muhammad was introduced to the teachings of Noble Drew Ali and Marcus Garvey very informally, as opposed to having simply imbibed them from the charged atmosphere of the period. End quote. While each of these movements had a certain degree of black separatism and nationalism in nature, both Garvey's UNIA or Noble Drew Ali's Moorish Science Temple took a far less adversarial approach toward the white ruling class than did Fard, who ironically referred to them as white devils. Neither Garvey or Ali promoted such rhetoric within their organizations. This new anti-white Christian radicalism was uniquely a characteristic of Fard Muhammad and his emerging Nation of Islam. Though being rumored to be a white devil himself, Fard's militant elocution of the black plight and plans for self-restoration through pride, proper diet, and piety were well received by the newly arrived Americans migrating to Detroit from the Jim Crow South. However, questions about his identity would continue to linger. As illustrated previously, the downfall or disappearance of a leader opens the door for new movements to splinter from the breakage. After the undoing of Garvey, whose organization, the UNIA, was extremely popular, a void existed within the community that the NAACP could not fill. Most historians agree that Garvey's UNIA was a socio-political movement as opposed to a religious one, even though Garvey was an avowed Catholic. But the groups that would splinter from the Garveyite factions transmutated into heterodoxical, religious, messianic, anti-Christian movements. In spite of the fact that Ali's temple is said to have been found in Newark in 1913 as the Canaanite temple, compelling evidence suggests that the temple could have been founded by Sudanese Egyptian immigrant Abdul Hamid Suleiman and was already in operation during Timothy Drew's early years in Newark. If this date holds true, Ali or Suleiman's temple operated contemporaneously with the inception of Garveyism. But records substantiating these early dates are deficient, disqualifying any pre-1920 existence or operation of either Ali or Suleiman of the Canaanite or Moorish temple. In any event, there is record verifying the relationship between Suleiman and the prominent Freemasons of Harlem, documented in the year 1922. Where in attendance we find John E. Bruce,
Arturo Skumberg, and Duse Muhammad, men who all had personal ties to Garvey. And by this time, the Black Star Line's disappointment, coupled with Garvey's impending legal troubles, marked the decline of the UNIA. Within the next 2 years, Suleiman would be arrested for child abuse. Garvey would be arrested for mail fraud. And Ali would incorporate his Moorish science temple from the ruins of the two. In just 4 years' time, Noble Drew Ali would be dead when mysteriously W.D. Fard, claiming he was Ali reincarnated or sent as a divine prophet, shows up in Detroit, peddling a new rebranded Islam from the shadows of his Moorish past, which of course included Christianized dogma. Fard's new Islam was distinctly anti-Christian and anti-white. In no less than another 4 years, Wallace Fard Muhammad disappears as mysteriously as he appeared. And Elijah Muhammad assumes leadership of the Nation of Islam for the next 40 years. Was Noble Drew Ali a Freemason? Many have attested that he was indeed, and even a photograph surfaced alleging to be him dressed in Masonic regalia. He was affiliated with high-ranking Freemasons, modeled much of his organization after Freemasonry, and dressed like J. Edgar Hoover when he was pretending to be a man, who sent his own Moors to infiltrate the temple. Drew also claimed that Black Americans were descended from the ancient Moabites. Who were the ancient Moabites? According to the Book of Numbers, the chief god of the Moabites was Chemosh. And the Moabites made human sacrifice to Chemosh and other gods. Later in the books of Ezra and Nehemiah, the God of Israel prohibits his people from intermarrying any Moabite woman who did not convert and continued worshiping strange gods. Are these the same Moabites Drew Ali claims Black Americans are descended from? Another sect of Moors claim ancestry from the Ben Ishmael tribe of the American Midwest, dating back to 1785, alleging to be comprised of Moorish conversos who in America intermarried with Scottish immigrants and indigenous Americans. According to studies, much of their ancestry has been genetically identified with the Melungeon people from the Ohio Territory and are said to be a triracial European, African, and Native American ancestry. As we know, many Moors and Sephardic Jews concealed their identity, migrated to America as slave traders, and later built a plantation empire. Is there any connection between them and the emerging popularity of Islam among Blacks in the early 20th century?